Let's please give a USC welcome to our special guest, Landon Donovan. Landon.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome to USC.
Thank you.
Welcome, welcome.
Thank
it's
you,
great
guys.
To have
I appreciate
you here.
That.
Fresh off a Ooh. Championship with the Galaxy. Little
yes,
time.
Sir.
This is sort of the first time you've spoken publicly since the championship, isn't it?
It's been a while, yeah. Kind of went into hiding a little bit. Needed some time this offseason to sort of relax. But before I forget, I want to thank you for having me here. This is overwhelming. I'm touched by this. Dean Ellis, I think, left. But this is an honor. And I've played in front of tens of thousands of people. And you get a rush from that. But this is equally as exciting for me. So thanks for having
me here. By the way, Dean Ellis has to be 10 places at one time, and he changed his schedule yesterday to be here, said, I really want to be here to welcome you. So
that's great.
He's going to hopefully raise money and get us a new building.
That's pretty nice.
What he does. For those of you who haven't been to one of our events before, it really is more about life than soccer or business, and we're trying to give you and explore different philosophies and frameworks that you can take and apply in your life. So even though you know his expertise is in soccer, we hope to shed some light on some things that you can use in your life. So what we do is we actually start from the beginning and sort of talk through his life, and we'll highlight it with a couple videos to so underscore some moments. So let's get started from the beginning. Where were you born and raised?
I grew up here off the 10 in Ontario, California, until I was about 10 years old, and then we moved further east out to Redlands, and that's where I spent better part of 7 years, from about 10 to 17.
And let's talk about your childhood. How many kids in your family?
So I have a twin sister, and then I have, my family's a little bit of a mess. My parents have both been married and divorced 3 times, so I have a good relationship. People to look up to, and I have half siblings from both mom and dad beforehand. So one of those siblings, half siblings, was my brother. So it's basically my sister, my brother, and I that grew up together.
Okay. So older brother, what did your mom do for work?
My mom taught special ed for 30 years, retired a few years ago.
Great.
Yeah.
And at what age did you start playing soccer?
My mom says I started as soon as I could start walking. My older brother sort of wanted me to finally do something in life. So as soon as I could start walking, we would kick the soccer ball around and have fun. And I guess organized, I started playing about 5 years old, which is about where most kids start.
So in your first game, it's funny, throughout your career, your debut game seemed to have some significance to them, or your debut seasons. How did your debut game go at 5? How many times did you score?
Well, I don't remember this person. My mom likes to tell this story. It could just be a bunch of BS, but she likes to tell this story that I scored, I think she says 7 goals in this first, which, I mean, is, I guess, possible, but I guess it was a good start, yeah.
And you're playing mostly with older kids, which is sort of a theme, too.
Right. I mean, at that time, as many of you will know, if you've played soccer, there was, most of the time, you show up to a soccer field and you kind of had the coach with the baseball hat and like a clipboard and a whistle and, you know, had never looked at a soccer ball in their life, so it was an interesting experience back then. As I now date myself, I realize.
And looking back on it, what did soccer give you as a kid? What was it for you?
So, I guess on the surface, people think, you just played soccer. It was this great thing. You loved it. It was enjoyable. All this, but for me, my parents got divorced when I was 2 years old. So. In retrospect, I realized that soccer, for me, gave me an identity. I had a twin sister, I had an older brother, and it was my way of sort of being a human being in the world. And when you're good at something, that sort of feeds on that, right? So when I realized I was good at it, and I got recognized for it as a child, that feels very good, and so I decided, well, this seems to work, you know, I'm doing good and people like it and people respect me for it, so I'm going to keep doing it.
So you continue to progress through grade school into high school. Soccer's not huge in the U.S. yet. There's no professional league back then. You go to your guidance counselor for advice. What is your dream when you're when you're that age? What's your dream career?
Well, this won't go over so well in this room, but at that age, at that point in my career, there was no league in our country. There was no Major League Soccer. I had no real athletes to look up to. At that point, believe it or not, especially for you in the media class, TV consisted of 5 or 7 channels, and that was it. So I had nobody, I had no reason to know anything about the soccer world. I just enjoyed playing the sport. I didn't know athletes, I didn't know players, I didn't know coaches, I didn't know teams, I knew nothing. I just loved playing the sport. And I believe it was in high school, my freshman year, we had a guidance counselor who would sort of help you and talk to you, look at your grades, and figure out what you wanted to do with your life. And I think I was probably like a, 3.3 GPA student, and I said to her, and this was my goal, I want to go to UCLA and get a scholarship. And I remember this so vividly, and you will probably hear a lot of stories like this from people, but I remember her coming back to me after she looked at my grades, and she said, well, why don't you consider something a little more reasonable? And I remember thinking at the time, like, how are you going to crush someone's dream like that? And but that was my goal at the time. My goal at the time was to get a scholarship and go to college so my parents didn't have to pay for it.
Well, 2 points about that. One, this audience must really like you because I've been doing this for 12 years, and that's the only time where that school did not elicit hisses and boos audibly. I actually warned him that there would be it, so I don't know what happened. And secondly, you know, nowadays you can get into UCLA much less than a 3.0, so you can probably do it.
It's fine. I have no allegiance.
Full ride. All right, so let's shift forward. You're 15 years old, and you know most 15-year-olds are happy being a freshman or sophomore in high school. How does your life change, and where do you go with soccer?
About 14 is when I started to realize that maybe there was a future here. So I started growing physically. I was a very skinny kid. I started to sort of thicken up and get a little beefier, and I started to develop physically, and I realized that, hey, I was pretty good at this. So actually my club coach at the time said I should go try out for what's called the Olympic Development Program, which sort of puts you on a track to be part of the youth national team. So we have the senior national team, which you see plays in the World Cup, and then you've got Olympic team, an under 20 team, and an under 17 team. And the beginning of that is this Olympic Development Program. So for me, it was just another chance to go play soccer, so I was ecstatic. So I went out and tried out. We had like numbers on our chest, the whole deal, like you're, you know, auditioning for American Idol or something. And I went out and played and did well, and just sort of progressed along the steps along the way, and eventually went into a camp where it was all these regional teams, and then we ended up playing a game against the existing under 17 national team. So I did well, went back home, and within a few weeks got an email saying we'd like to invite you in to the under 17 national team. And this is a little bit of an interesting story and another story you may hear over and over from people. As you can imagine, I was over the moon excited to have this chance to go try out, or to go be with the under 17 national team after I'd spent my whole life sort of leading to this. And literally the day before, it was a Sunday, I'll never forget, I was playing a game with my club team. And I'm a forward or striker, someone who scores goals and doesn't generally defend that much. And for some reason, I thought it would be a good idea to go try to slide tackle somebody. And literally the first time I think in my life I had tried to slide tackle someone. And I tried to slide tackle this kid, my toe got caught under me, and I just heard pop, pop, and broke my leg. And a day before I was supposed to go into this camp, and as you can imagine, I was pretty devastated. So I remember crying the entire way home with my mom, and she took me to the hospital. I had to get it casted up. And looking back on it now, it was arguably one of the better things that ever happened to me. You never know, I guess, what could have been, but I probably wasn't prepared at that time. I think, you know, my dad used to always tell me, you know, you're 15, you think you're so invincible, and probably still for some of you, and probably still for me sometimes, we think we're invincible and that we're not mortal. And this was a sort of first wake-up call to say, you know what, not as cool as you think you are, and things can happen. So I had that, at that point I was devastated, but I realized it is what it is, and you just got to keep going. And eventually I did get called back in, and it worked out much better than it potentially could have.
So you come back to the under 17 national team. You have sort of unprecedented success. How did you guys finish in that?
So we went to the under 17 World Cup. We finished fourth, which was further than, and I think still further than any under 17 team has ever done. We had gone, a big part for that was we had gone into this first ever residency program in Florida. So at 16, I moved away from home. We went to school in the morning. Well, they called it school. It was like this, it was garbage. But we went to school from 8 to 12, and then afternoons we would train and play together. And all of that being together for about a year led into the World Cup, and then we ended up finishing fourth, which was pretty exciting.
So the highest finish for a U.S. under 17 team. And even though you finished fourth, you were selected as the most valuable player of the tournament, which is sort of rare. You think about most times the MVP is the best player on the championship team, right? You don't ever see them going off camera and say, hey, the guy that finished 2 days ago, he's the MVP. So you obviously set yourself apart then. You're 17 years old, and you get the opportunity to play overseas. How did that invitation come? And then tell us about your mindset of going to play in Germany, don't speak the language, playing with older people again, you're 17 years old.
Right.
Walk us through that.
When I was 16, I was playing with the under 17 national team, and I got scouted by a team from Germany. And again, like I had alluded to earlier, I knew nothing about anything in the soccer world. So when someone came and said, we're from this team in Germany, I was like, oh, great, you know. Like. And they said, no, we'd like you to come play for us. And at the time, I was living, it was my mom, my sister, and I really living together. And I mean, we were clueless. We had no idea. So our first job was find someone who can help us. And fortunately, and you know, whatever you believe or don't believe, I'm not particularly religious, but from some act of something, I met a gentleman who's here tonight, my agent at the time, who was able to guide me and help me through the process. And so eventually I decided, maybe against mom's better wishes, because she was a teacher and wanted me to go to school, that I was gonna go to Germany at 17 and try to play for this team.
And tell us about your experience. How, you know,
so
you're usually the best player on the team.
Sure.
How was it going to arriving there?
Sure. Well, I had come from, you know, being a star on my high school team, being a star on my club team, being named the best player at this under 17 World Cup. So I sort of thought I was, you know, the best thing since sliced bread. And I went to this team in Germany, and I quickly realized that I was one of 20, 30, 40, 50 other kids who were in the exact same boat, from Czechoslovakia or Turkey or Italy or whatever. They do this. This is the way it functions. They bring in all these kids with potential, and they try to make, you know, if one of them comes to fruition, they're happy, and the others are just, you know, whatever, they'll figure it out. And so I sort of strutted in there, the 17-year-old, thinking I'm so great. And I realized quickly that not only did all those kids not care what I had done, but also these were kids that were coming from, in a lot of cases, very poor backgrounds, that this was their livelihood. For me, this was like, oh, I get to make money. I'm 17. I'm making 50 grand a year. This is cool, you know? And these kids were like, if I don't make money, my mom and dad, you know, might not get off the street. And so that was a very eye-opening experience. And it was tough for me. I had, I didn't have any older players that could say this is the way it's going to be. I didn't have any mentors in that way. I mean, Rich helped me a lot, but it was an eye-opening experience. And because of that, the initial excitement of being on your own and being independent at 17 sort of wore off, and realized that it's not that cool if you're here to play soccer and you're not getting a chance to play. And it was difficult for me.
So probably a little bit humbling experience to come back. You decided you wanted to come back to the U.S., play in the U.S. Is that right about 2000 for the World Cup, or is it before that?
It was in 2001, so I'd been there for about 2 years, and it was getting to a point where I remember, and Rich can attest to this, that I hit the point where I was on the verge of just saying, you know what, this isn't for me. I'm here in Germany. I'm not enjoying myself. I'm not playing, so I might just quit. You know, I don't owe anybody anything. I just, if I'm not enjoying this, I'm not going to play. And fortunately, again, Rich was able to work out a scenario where I could come back to the States, play in San Jose, California for a couple years, and then after that, the agreement was then to go back and see, you know, if I developed. And this happens all over the world in the soccer world. If you're not playing for one team, they'll loan you out to a team that's maybe of a lower division or not as good so that you get playing time and then with the hope that you develop.
Right. So it's about 2000, Olympics are in 2000, right?
Right.
So this is the first experience in the Olympics.
Sure.
You're 18 at this point. Can you talk about sort of the expectations heading into the Olympics, what your role was, probably the youngest guy on the team?
Right.
And how did that experience go for you?
Well, the Olympics are an under-23 tournament, so the majority of the players there are 21, 22, in some cases 23, and I was 18, but this was on the heels of this under-17 championship. I thought I was great. I signed this contract in Germany, so I went with the Olympic team, and again, all of sort of at the same time, didn't get a chance to play much. I didn't play the first game. I didn't play the second game. I got subbed into the third game and got to play a little bit sporadically throughout the tournament, but the team ended up finishing fourth, which was great, but it was sort of a bittersweet for me because I didn't get to play a lot, and coupled with what was going on in Germany and not playing and not getting opportunities, this whole time of my life was very humbling before 2001.
So your agent negotiates for you to come back to the San Jose team, mm-hmm, in the MLS. And your first year is 2001, right?
Correct.
2001. How'd that season go?
So that was pure joy because for the first time in my career, I got to play. And the best thing that happened to me, and we'll talk about this later, but because of my parents' split up, my dad wasn't involved in our life a lot of my childhood. So what happened at that time was I got connected with a coach in San Jose who really believed in me. And I think for the first time, you know, thinking about it now, for the first time in my life, I had this sort of father figure that actually believed in me, that didn't abandon me in some ways, and that was there for me. So when I started with San Jose, the team the year before had finished dead last. We started the season, and I didn't play the first two games, but the third game I played, and the team won, and so I got to play the next game. And we went on this streak, I think, of about 12 games where we didn't lose. But the irony in all of it, I was a forward, and I didn't score a single goal. And so in most cases, almost anywhere in the world, if that were the case, you wouldn't play as a forward. But I had a coach who believed in me, the team was doing well, and he just stuck with me. And eventually I scored, we got better and better and better, and then ended up winning the championship.
So first year in the league, you have a great experience, you win the championship, and you talked about it. What was the coach's name?
Frank Yallop.
And talk about what it meant to have a mentor that, you know, what did it give you in terms of confidence?
Well, I mean, I don't know the dynamics of the room here, but for people that come from single family homes, especially as a male not having their father, there was a lot of lessons I didn't learn as a child. You know, I didn't know how to change a tire. I didn't know how to, you know, there's a lot of things I didn't learn. There was also a lot of support I didn't have from male figures. So to have someone give that and be that for me was incredible. And that season wouldn't have gone the way it did for me and probably for the team had I not had him there in that way. And he got it. He understood where I was coming from. A lot of times I would say, we'd play Saturday and I'd say, you know, on Sunday I'd say, can I fly home to LA and see my family? I miss him. And he'd say, no problem. You can miss training. Go. Just do what you have to do. And he just sort of understood it. And it made a big difference in my life.
That's great. Let's go to 2002. This is your first World Cup, right? In South Korea?
Right.
Always dreamed of playing in a World Cup, I assume. Can you take us through that, getting the call to play on the national team and your expectations in the World Cup, your role, and then really paint the picture for us as if we were there with you.
So since I had been a little kid, the only thing I knew about soccer in any way was there was this World Cup every 4 years, and I didn't even watch World Cups. I went to one World Cup game in 94 when it was here in America, but I didn't really understand it. I didn't really get the gist of it. It was just this exciting event. But as I got older, you know, maybe 13, 14, 15, I started realizing a little bit more about it, and I just set my sights on that's what I want to do in my career. I want to play in a World Cup. It was like stereotypical out in the backyard, you know, 5 seconds left, Donovan has the ball, and you know, all this bullshit. And but it was this realistic goal it was this concrete goal that I had to shoot for. So in 2002, we had a training camp in the beginning of 02, and it was sort of this last camp. There was about 30 some odd guys, and from that, they would pick 23 to go to the World Cup. And I'll never forget the day I got the call from the coach saying, you know, you made the team, you're on the roster. And I remember calling my mom, and she remembers it pretty vividly too, and I was just crying, and I said, Mom, I made the fucking team, I made the fucking team. And she's like, watch your mouth. I was like, oh, sorry. And so, obviously, very exciting time. So, as the World Cup neared, I mean, I was in like machine mode, because this is all I had ever dreamed of, and all I ever wanted, and I wanted to make the absolute most of it. So, the first game comes, and I remember the team was relatively set. There was a couple of us, myself and a kid named DeMarcus Beasley, a kid from Indiana who had sort of come up through the under-17 level, the under-20s, the Olympic team level, come up together. And we were the only two young guys on the entire team. So we had this group of older guys, veterans who had been around, and we were sort of like the young blood. So I remember our first game, we walked down the tunnel for warm-ups. And it gives me chills thinking about it still. We walk down the tunnel, and I look out at the stadium, and I peek out, and there's just, the stadium's packed, 50, 60,000 people. There's cheering, chanting, and I remember looking over at him, and he looked back, and I'm just like, are you kidding me, dude? Like, can you believe this? So we walked down, went through the tournament. The tournament went very well for our team. We got to the quarterfinals, and it was just, I mean, talk about dreams coming true, and that was absolutely a dream coming true.
You've played internationally and here at home now. Can you, especially for the sports and media class, can you compare the fervor of the fans in Europe and the scrutiny in Europe as compared to the same things here?
Yeah, it's a good question. It's interesting. I mean, you see other sports in America, and you see sort of the scrutiny. And I was listening to sports radio today, and they were talking about Darrell Rivas, a football player, and I think Richard Sherman, another football player, and they're having this Twitter war. And all. And to me, it's so stupid, right? But it's interesting how much importance is placed on those things. And that's how it is in Europe, and that's how it is around a World Cup with the media. And it's changed so much, you know. In 2002, I keep feeling so old when I say all this stuff. In 2002, there was no Twitter, there was no Facebook, really. There was no social media, there was none of this. So we were sort of in this bubble in South Korea where we had no clue what was going on in the world. And the juxtaposition of that versus 2010, which we'll get to me, it's mind-blowing in 8 years what has changed in the media world. So we had no clue what was going on. We had no understanding. All we knew is that, you know, there was a lot of attention, things we weren't used to in Major League Soccer. There was much more of a media presence. We were told constantly, be careful what you say, be careful how you act, that kind of stuff. But we were really insulated from a lot of it.
And how did it hit home for you when you came home? What was sort of the aha moment when you realized things are changing?
So we played our last game. We lost to Germany in the quarterfinals. And I flew home the next day. I remember landing in LA. I actually went to Rich's house to stay at their house. And I landed and I wanted to go, I don't know if it was like Coffee Bean or something. I went to, I'm not sponsored by Coffee Bean, by the way. It's not like a, but I went to grab something and I looked down and there was an LA Times. And there was a picture of me on the cover I think sitting on the field or something with my head in my hands or something, and it just hit me, and I was like, holy shit, you know, like, this is crazy. And like I said, we were so insulated from it, I had no idea, but it was this moment where up to that point, I mean, and you could argue people really still don't care that much, although I would argue when you see a class like this that maybe do people do care about soccer nowadays, but you could argue at that point for sure that nobody really cared what was going on, but this moment sort of hit me like, wow, we may have had some sort of impact, and it was really cool. As sad as it was to see that picture, it was still really cool.
Yeah, and I think 20 years, 50 years, 100 years from now, people will sort of be looking back and talking about the people who helped build the sport, and you're certainly going to be one of them. So the next step, you come back 2003, you're still with the San Jose mm-hmm. team in the MLS. How'd that season go?
That season was great as well. We won the championship that year. That was good, and that was, I sort of was starting to become, like, the first few years are just this, that you get to play are this sort of ecstasy and this excitement. 2001 went great, 2002 went great, 2003 went great. So you almost start thinking, you know, like, this is how it is. You know, you just win every year and everything's great and everything's exciting, but as we'll learn, it's not always the case.
So in the championship game, I think you scored twice. You're the MVP of the championship game. So you've won, in your first 3 years, you've won two championships. In 2005, you get traded to the Galaxy.
Right.
Again, a finesse move by one agent, Motzkin, to get you to the Galaxy. What is it like to come home, sort of your as close as a home team as you have?
Well, as athletes, the majority of our lives are dictated by others. And so this is one of my biggest frustrations with sports in general is you can feel like you have very little control over your life and your career. And it's very frustrating because they tell you sort of when to play, where to go, in some cases where, you know, what to eat, how to act, all this stuff. So you can get caught up into this sort of almost feeling like a robot, like you're doing what they say. And I know that seems crazy, probably looking from afar, but that's very much the reality of it. So to have the opportunity in some ways to control my destiny a little bit and be able to come home and play in front of my family was beautiful and golden. And a lot of athletes could only dream of that. And fortunately for me, and thanks to Rich and a few others, it was capable of happening.
So you come to the LA Galaxy in 2005. And by the way, if we went and covered every highlight and every award, we'd be here all night. We'd never get to the good stuff. So let's we'll skip it. But geez, how did 2005 go with the LA Galaxy?
2005 was a good year. we won the championship that year. It's good.
So what's interesting about your sport is the, you know, the transition from, you know, the club to the Olympics, to the World Cup. I mean, there's just always something, you know, every other year there's another massive event that you have to insert into your professional career if you
right.
want to play at the highest levels.
Right.
So 2006, the World Cup, you're 24 years old. It's in Germany, I think, in mm-hmm. 2006. Talk about that experience going in. So you're older, you're more experienced, you probably got more of a leadership role. What were your expectations, and what were the expectations for the team going in?
Right. So, as you can imagine, let's go back. In 98 in the World Cup, the team lost all three games, they finished last, and they were out of the tournament. So the expectation level for 02 was zero. We do well, so you can imagine now with media emerging the way it is, the expectation level in 06 is massive. And, you know, in my opinion, much of life is about expectations, right? If I come here and I expect that there's going to be 10 people in the front row, it's different than if I come and expect there's going to be 30,000 people in the Gailey Center, and it's a whole different story. So I wish I had known that lesson then, but the expectation then, we were ranked fourth in the world, I think. The expectation was we were going to breeze through our group. We were going to hopefully do better than the quarterfinals like we had the time previous, but that didn't happen. And the world doesn't care about, you know, Mother Earth doesn't care about expectations. You know, the world is happening as it's supposed to. And that was a harsh reality that set in. So in 06, we lost our first game. We got killed in our first game. Second game, we played a good game. We tied. And then the third game, we lost, and we were out of the tournament. And so along with all the great that had come from 02, and I was sort of hailed as this young hero and all this, now you get to 06, expectations on the team, on myself, and whether either were fair or unfair, whether I merited the 02 hailing or whether I didn't merit the 06 sort of burden is irrelevant. The reality is the reality. And after 06, there was a lot of blame put on myself. There was a lot of disappointment amongst people who expected better. Even casual fans were like, oh, what is this? We got into this, you made us watch these games, and now this is what happens. So so the interesting part for me after that was when I got home in 02, there was this crazy high when I got home. I'm on the cover of LA Times, and there's magazines and appearances and being on David Letterman, all this stuff too. 06, I come home and I'm just hearing and reading things about what a failure I'd been and how terrible I was and all this. So that was the first time in my life where I had really failed in my career. And it was really hard for me. There was a 2-week period where I went into a pretty decent depression and just had some moments where, again, I thought, you know what, I don't know if this is worth it. I don't really want to deal with this. This is difficult, and it was very hard.
Well, you think about it, if you remember that time, as a fan's perspective, you know, it was this pivot point where the country was starting to really, you know, believe and pay attention, the expectations were there. So the casual fans, the one who really don't know soccer, and I was one of them. no, but you finally tuned in. You're like, this is it. This is going to happen. They're actually good now. They compete on a world level. And right. It was, you know, uno, dos, adios, or tres, adios. You're out in 3 games. And so for us, it was like, oh, man, you know, you sort of took us on this. For you, you know, the burden of that. So what did you do? You're home. You're beyond a funk. You're depressed.
Yeah.
What do you do?
Well, looking back now, and I think you guys will find this in your lives as you go forward, it's very hard when you're in it to see this, but when you get out of it, you look back, and I think you would attest to this too. The moments that are hardest in your life are oftentimes the best thing that ever happened to you. And you can't fathom it when you're in the midst of it, but if you can sort of trust it, and just know that, I mean, it could be anything. It could be a breakup from boyfriend or girlfriend. It can be something as seemingly meaningful as being blamed for a World Cup loss. There's all ends of the spectrum. And so I think it's important to remember that if you can be aware of it. But for me, my choices were sit in this and be miserable with it. Or learn from it and go forward. And it took some time, but eventually I got to the place where I said, I'm really going to learn from this and go forward. And I've always been pretty honest with myself. And when I looked at it, I said, you know what? As much as it hurt, I didn't do my best. I didn't prepare the best. I wasn't ready. I wasn't myself. And I could have done better. And once I realized that and got past it, it was a great learning experience, and I promised myself that from there on I was gonna do those things.
And did you get an outsider's opinion on what you were going through? Did you get somebody else to talk to?
Well, initially it was, you know, I was in a deep place, but at that point in my life, I had just gotten married in 06. My wife, now my ex-wife, had been seeing a therapist for a while, and she kept suggesting, you know, maybe you should go see a therapist, maybe you should go see a therapist, and not about this, about other things in general, but so finally I succumbed reluctantly and went, and I mean, thankfully, because it ended up being, again, one of the best decisions of my life. And I learned so much more about myself by finally going to talk to somebody and getting help for not a soccer issue, but for life issues.
And those are connected. We'll talk about that in a minute. But
right.
No, I, you know, sitting here and talking to you and entrepreneurs and Pete Carroll, and so many people have said getting fired was the best thing that ever happened to me. Losing my company was the best thing that ever happened to me, because that's when you learn, right?
Right.
You don't learn when things are going really well, right?
Exactly.
And so did you use sort of that failure, perceived failure, to sort of inspire a better performance and motivate you for the next time?
Yeah, and you know, it was more about me as a person, because I know what I'm doing. If you put a soccer ball there, I know what to do with it, right? It's not, I've been doing it my whole life, so it's not like this, I don't believe that there's this innate, God-given talent that I just knew how to kick a soccer ball when I came out of the womb. It was years and years of practice and understanding. Obviously, there's athletic gifts that you have, but I know what to do with that. It was more of, why didn't I do what I know how to do in Germany? And learning those sorts of things were so much more valuable than, you know, pumping weights in a weight room or taking 50 shots on the goal, you know?
I was very tempted to put a soccer ball right there, by the way.
Don't do it. I haven't played in a few months.
Took everything in my power not to, like, set up, you know, goals around the audience. So going back to sort of your professional career, it's now 2007, I guess, yeah. So we finished the World Cup in 2006, 2007, and there's a new era coming to Los Angeles. What is arriving in Los Angeles, and how
there's
does it impact you?
Certain Englishman who I'm sure many of the ladies in here are quite fond of, Mr. Beckham, that came to our team. And for us, it was, from a media perspective, for those of you who are here, it was mind-boggling, because we had gone from this team that was in relative anonymity to all of a sudden a massive spotlight on everything we did, and in particular everything David did. But I learned some quite interesting lessons about what to do and not what to do with regards to public speaking.
Well, yeah, that's putting it deftly.
Yeah.
So what is the immediate impact on you, and that you're the leader of the team when he came, right?
Let me preface all of this by saying, hopefully no one's recording this, actually, they probably are. Let me preface all of this by saying, I genuinely like David. I realized, and I'll talk about it in a minute, I realized my issues with David initially. And for those of you who are sort of in the dark, we had a writer follow us for a year and document everything. And during this time when David first came, the first couple weeks we got there, I was asked to relieve my duties as the captain and let David be the captain. And I realized very quickly that I could either fight it, and it was going to happen anyway, or I could take the approach that I'm happy to do this for you, David. I hope that it helps the team. And you know, maybe in retrospect I would have done it differently, but I was, as some people get forced out of a job, I was forced out of the captaincy. So that was an immediate sort of blow to my psyche, and probably the psyche of the team a little bit, to hand over the keys to the car to a guy who had just come. And that was a little bit of a difficult start to all of it.
So that's 2007. I mean,
yeah.
You were also the face of the league, and he's sort of brought in and promoted as sort of a newer club. Not a new face of the league, but another person who's got sort of worldwide visibility.
Sure.
So 2000, 2007, and 2008, how's the team do?
Terribly.
Terribly. So things change, team doesn't perform on the field.
Right.
2009.
Really quickly about that. So this guy followed our team and spoke with many of us throughout the year. And through this time, it was very frustrating because we'd had a decent team. David came. You know, not necessarily just because of him. There was many factors involved, but the team didn't do well, and we were all very frustrated. And instead of being a man and just speaking to him about it, I decided to air my dirty laundry through this writer. And there was a book that came out, and it caused quite a bit of friction between everybody. And so, needless to say, I learned some valuable lessons through all that. But it was a very difficult time.
I remember it. So 2009 comes, and team's improving. This is, by the way, all those years that they say the team doesn't do well, he's an all-star every year. There's not been a year when he hasn't been an all-star of the league. So individually, he's playing well. In 2009, you have your best year of your career from a lot of perspectives. Mm-hmm. We talked about sort of the connection between personal life and professional life and how sometimes when your personal life's out of sync, it really does impact your professional life and vice versa.
Yeah.
How did things sort of come together for you in 2009?
All right, so this will be a long-winded answer, I'll let you guys know. But this year for me, 2009, was the best year of my life for many reasons. And it's an emotional year for me. It was a special year for me. So beginning of 2009, I spent the first 2 months in Germany playing for a couple months on loan in Germany. And during this time, I had been married for a couple years, and for some reason, there was something inside me that was pulling me to get out of that and to be free. And I had no idea what it was. It was just this gut feeling, and I didn't know how to place it or where to put it. And like I told you guys earlier, as an athlete, you have this idea that everybody controls your life, right? So you don't get to make decisions for yourself very often. And I think because of that, at least in part, also because of the fact that I grew up without a father, I became this, I won't use the word I want to use, but I became a, not a great man. I became I wasn't a masculine person in any way. I grew up with a twin sister and my mom, and in my marriage, I subsequently became similar in many ways. I became a child, and she was sort of more of a mother figure as opposed to being a man and a woman who are together. And that obviously does not work in a marriage. You're not really attracted to your mom. I hope not. So that doesn't work well in a marriage. So now, looking back, I realize that was the reason that was not working out. So I decided that I had to leave. And it was not a fun time for either of us, but I had to do it and I had to get out of it. And through all that, I was going to a lot of therapy. And there was one moment in therapy where I was speaking to my therapist about what was going on, and we had this moment where she said, "What are you feeling? What's going on with you? Why do you feel like you need to leave? Why do you feel like you needed to leave?" And I said, "Well, let me start back quickly. At this point, from 20 till 26 years old, I had a falling out with my dad, and we didn't speak at all. And sort of because of the way we grew up and his lack of being in my life, I became angry about it and bitter about it, and I just tuned him out and shut him off. So she said, "What were you feeling? What was your mindset? Why did you need to leave?" And I said, "Well, because of my career and because of this marriage I was in, I felt trapped. I was scared a lot of the time. I gotten into this situation I didn't know how to get out of. I didn't make any conscious decisions, really. I was sort of just going along with the flow. When she wanted to be serious, I decided to get serious. When she wanted to get engaged, I was like, sure, let's get engaged. And when she wanted to get married, it was the same. I was like, okay, whatever, I guess that's the next step. They were never conscious choices on my part. And she said, "So, tell me more about it." And I said, "Well, that's how I felt. I felt like I was trapped, like I couldn't get out. I was scared. I needed something. I needed to just get away." And she stopped and she looked at me and she said, "Well, who does that remind you of?" And I had this aha moment and I said, "That's probably how my dad felt when he was two. He had these twin children. He was still selfish. He didn't know how to act. He didn't know where to go. He just felt trapped in it. And at that point, I'd had this like groin injury for about a year. And it was sort of just this nagging injury. And when she said that and I made the connection, I just broke down and I lost it. And in addition to having this like very noticeable relief and weight lifted off my shoulders, literally, I remember this groin issue was gone like that. And, you know, say what you want about anything, but in my opinion, that was all me just holding on to whatever was there and whatever anger was there. And I had sort of that aha moment where it all connected to me, and in that moment, all my hatred, all my disdain, all my disgust, all my bitterness towards my dad was gone, and that was it. And in that moment, I forgave him. I could finally see where he was coming from. I had compassion for him. And within a few weeks, I emailed him and said, "Can I come see you?" And he said, "I would love that." And I flew to Nashville, saw him, and we've had a great relationship ever since.
It's very powerful. Thanks for sharing that. It's interesting to look at your parents through, you know, by their age. You know, now you may be probably about the age that he was maybe when he had kids. I don't know if he was 30 or a little bit older, but, you know, Yep. They don't have all the answers. You know, they're just trying to do the best they can at that particular time. So it's a good perspective. You talked about how your physical health is tied to your sort of emotional health, and if things are bad at home, you know, it doesn't matter how great work is because it's bad. So let's go forward to sort of some better times. 2010. This is sort of you've had the 2006 disappointment, now we're at 2010 World Cup. It's in South Africa. That will not hit you on the head, by the way.
Hope not.
So, you're fine.
I know.
What's your role on the team at this point? And what are the expectations going into the tournament for you?
Well, I'll finish the 09 story. The end of that is that, so that happened, that's okay. That happened in probably May, all of that. In June, we had a tournament in South Africa, which was sort of the precursor to the World Cup the next year in 2010. And not coincidentally, that was the best month of soccer I ever played in my entire career. I was just free and able to do I just felt this sense of freedom. And I'm not encouraging that people who are in relationships to just get out of relationships now and everything will be great and you'll be an entrepreneur and all this, but for me, it was the right thing to do, and it was this great moment, and subsequently then I played the best soccer I'd ever played, and that carried on for the next couple years. So in 2010, again, the expectations went, you know, 02, 06, 2010, there was no expectation, really. But I was in a great place. I think the team was in a good place, and we had a pretty memorable trip.
Pretty memorable. Well, take us through the first game. What happened? Who'd you play and what happened?
So we played England in the first game. It was kind of an ugly game. We ended up tying 1-1. So for those of you that aren't familiar, in a World Cup, you're in a group with four teams. You play each of the other three teams, and the top two teams advance to the next round. So you have to finish in the top two. So our first game was a tie against England, who was sort of the prohibitive favorite in the group. So it was a pretty good result for us. The second game, we ended up tying 2-2. We were down 2-0 at halftime. We were able to come back and tie the game 2-2. So the third game, we needed to win to advance. And
So the second game, for those of you who remember this, is the game against Slovenia. They're down 2-0. They come back, and Landon almost kills a man with a soccer ball. That out of pure self-preservation, the goalie just had to duck from, you know, point-blank range. But everything was on the line. You don't advance. You have a good team. Not expected to advance necessarily, but people are thinking you should. And so everything's on the line against Algeria. And how does that game go? I mean, is it a high-scoring affair?
So,
what happens?
I mean, hopefully some of you got to watch it. It was... it's crazy because if you think of it in the context of you sort of live your whole life for games like this as an athlete. You practice so many hours, and you guys spend so many hours doing what you're doing. And in life, you might have one moment to make a difference, and you're either ready for it or you're not. And you don't know when it's coming. You know, nobody has a crystal ball and says, if you go to this class, or if this person comes to you, or you don't know, and you don't know when that moment might be. So you have to be prepared. And so this game had all the emotions because we had to win. You know, they hit the crossbar early. They could have been up a goal. We had a bunch of great chances. It's sort of this back and forth game because Algeria had nothing to play for, but, you know, politically, there's so many issues between Algeria and the U.S. There's all sorts of things that factor into these games. And they wanted to beat us desperately, even though they had nothing to play for. They wanted to beat us desperately. So we play 90-plus minutes. It's 0-0. We have to win the game, so we're just sort of pushing and pushing and trying to find a goal. And then eventually we get the goal.
So we're going to show a clip, but it's not the goal. The goal you saw at the beginning in the highlights. This is that someone made a YouTube video that's now 4 or 5 million views of the reaction of bars and people around the States. So if you can roll that, I just want you to see the reaction, and then we're going to talk about playing for your club versus your country. It gives me chills to watch that.
Me too.
Again, how does it make you feel, honestly, to watch
that
again?
Well, I've seen it a few times, admittedly. but it's just crazy to me. I told you about '02, where we had no idea what was going on. And then you see this, and we were able to see this the next morning. I was walking to breakfast at our little, we were like staying at this little lodge, and one of our PR guys came up to me and said, dude, you gotta see this. And I said, okay. And we walked in to their like media, our little media center we had set up, and he showed me. I just started crying. And the reason, like, I've been playing this game since I was 2 years old, as I've been telling you guys. So for me, it's this moment where it's sort of just, it's what I do, it's my job, I get paid to do this, and it was exciting and it was emotional for me on the field, but I didn't understand the context of it, right? And I didn't understand that this was going on back home. And so to be able to then walk in and, you know, open up a computer screen and see what this meant to people, I mean, I can imagine our bench going, as the ball gets crossed, going, oh, and then the goalie saves it, and they go, oh, and then we score, and they go, yeah, and you see that in every person in there. And you also see a guy pan down and try to get a girl's ass shot. I mean, we're all human, right? So it was just great. It was such a cool moment, and to be able to understand that you can impact people that way, you know, for me, it's sort of, it's a game. You know, at the end of the day, my mom taught special ed for 30 years. My sister teaches moderate to severe disabled kids. So I have a pretty good perspective on what's important in life. But it is cool to be able to inspire people in that way.
And the difference between the feeling of playing for a club versus playing for your country?
Right. So athletes in our country that play other sports, you know, if Kobe Bryant makes or misses a shot, the people of LA are, you know, happy or sad, or some people in LA are happy or sad. When you play in a World Cup and you play for your country, there's this extreme sense of pride and responsibility for your country. And having the opportunity to provide that for people is so special. And you know, the other end of that spectrum is 06, where you feel like you let everybody down. And you know, perception is reality, right? So if that's the perception, then that's the reality. And you know, that's why you can see such extreme highs and lows. And that's why I would encourage all of you, if you ever get a chance, to go to a World Cup and see it in person, it's unlike anything you'll ever experience.
Compare it, I mean, another level than our football league, than National Football League.
Of course.
Not even close.
I mean, yeah. Yeah.
Well, we're gonna finish this part of the talk with the last couple years, and then we're gonna open up for your questions. Can we pull these back a little bit for student questions? I know they may have to be close, but like, that's a little bit too Oliver Twist for us to come up that close. Just can you pull them back a little bit? So let's talk about the last 2 years in the MLS, actually the last three, 2010 to 2012. 2010, the Galaxy it wins the Supporters' Shield for...
most points during the season.
Most points they're seeing, best record. You lose in the semis, right?
Right.
In 2011, same thing happens. You win the Supporters' Shield championship game against Houston.
Mm-hmm.
You win.
Right.
What's the score?
1-0.
Who scored?
Stop, man.
Landon scores the lone goal, 1-0. He's the MVP. What do they call the MVP in soccer, by the way?
MVP.
I saw it like listed as man of the match or something.
Oh, yeah,
like that.
Sometimes.
I was like, man of the match. I
kind of feel like, yeah, I'm the man.
Man of the match.
Yeah, that's cool.
And so let's shift to this year. So 2012, Galaxy has a good year,
right,
generally speaking. It's sort of known going in to the playoffs that it's David Beckham's last run, right? It's his last time. So there's a lot of scrutiny before the game. There's also consideration in your mind as to where you are in life before that game. Can you tell us about before the game, what's going through your mind? This is the championship game against Houston again. What's going through your mind as you prepare?
Well, I hit a point last year, probably middle of last year, where all of this has sort of become a lot, and it's pretty overwhelming. And you know, I've as you've heard, I've had different moments in my life where if it's not been enjoyable for me, I don't want to do it. And I don't feel an obligation to play soccer. I don't feel I need to for whatever reason. I want to do it because I enjoy it. I really do believe I have a lot more to give than kicking a soccer ball in a field. And I got to a place where this, all of this had become so much and so overwhelming. And so I made it clear to people who needed to know, coaches, et cetera, that after this season, I just needed to take a break. And so this was, you know, and I didn't know how long the break was. I was just going into it with an open mind, and potentially it could have been forever. It could have been a few months, could have been a year, I didn't know. But I needed a break, and I just needed to get away from it all. So going into this game was, you know, it was an interesting feeling for me because I was sort of so exhausted from the weight of the last 15 years and really the last, you know, 28 years of my life. So I was sort of like muster up the strength for one more time and try to get it done.
So the scene is set. It's David Beckham, you know, big international star. It's his final game. It may be your final game. Place is going nuts. Let's take a look at the highlights from the game, and then we'll talk about what's happened since then. But can you roll this clip?
I want to make two comments on that. One, there's There's a lot of interesting lessons you learn in sports, if you want to, and they're so applicable to life. In that game, early on, about 10 minutes, I don't know how much you guys were paying attention, but there was a clip that I had a wide open chance in front of the goal, a play where 9 out of 10 times or more, I score. And I hit the ball wide. And if that had happened when I was 20, I would have been done for the rest of the game. And I've learned that the past, except in learning experiences, is so useless for all of us. And we get so caught up in what has happened. And we, you know, people go to bed and go, oh, or trying to go to bed and go, oh, I could have done this better today, I could have done that better today. And it's irrelevant and it's useless. You can learn from things, and clearly you should. But once something's over and it's done. And that's good and bad, right? You know, you can't live off what you've been doing. For I can come in here and say I won 5 championships, I'm so great. When I go into training, my coach doesn't give a shit. You know, he wants me to perform today, and it's very true. And so it took me a few minutes in that game, because you do feel like you let people down when you miss a chance like that, but you have to keep going, and you have to worry about what's next. And I think it's such an important lesson, and you learn that, fortunately, in sports, and you're going to come across that over and over in life, and I think it's really helpful. I forgot my other point.
Yeah, dude.
Sorry.
That's a great lesson. Anyway. It's deep. I was just going to ask you, what's up with the beard?
Oh. Yeah, no, that's my...
That was your playoff beard?
That's my playoff beard, yeah. I remember my other point, sorry.
Go ahead.
The other piece to that is, and I don't want to get all philosophical, but I truly believe that the world is happening the way it's supposed to. I made that comment earlier. And you call it what you want. People say things happen for a reason, fate, destiny, whatever. I believe that the faster you accept things to be what they are, the easier life is going to be. And I think we fight things so much. And so I could have said to myself, why didn't I make that shot? Why did my foot go out this way? Why? Maybe the ball was bouncing. Maybe this, maybe that. It is what it is. It happened. It's over. And if you trust that the world is working in your favor, life is much easier. If you get dumped, if something happens, the faster you come to terms with it and just accept it and let it be what it is, the easier life is.
Oh, that's great advice. That's great advice. This is the last question. Then you guys come on up and ask questions. Get in line right now so we can cut to you guys. We only got a few minutes. After the game, watching it, from the stands, and watching you guys celebrate, it looked, you know, everyone's going nuts, and I watched you, and it seemed like you were more relieved than ecstatic, like everyone was really celebrating, and there was a point at which it seemed like you were sort of saying goodbye. Did you not have your mind made up at that point?
Well, no, I didn't have my mind made up, but like I had just said, I mean, it was very relieving. As exciting as it was to win the game, it also meant the off season is here, you know, and I don't like feeling that way. And so I made the point to myself that if I'm going to go back and play, I'm going to do it when I want to play again, because I don't care what you do in life, if you're not enjoying it, it's not worth it. And, you know, as you get older, and I'm sure I'm just going to keep learning this, and you could probably tell me more about this. You have to do what, I mean, you have to do what makes you happy. And if you're not, it's just not worth it. I can't stress that enough.
That's great advice. Let's open up some questions. Jeff's class, my class, come on up. 2 mics right here. Don't be shy, just because there's 700 people here.
That a girl. My favorite player that I've... So there's a custom in soccer, you sort of change jerseys after a game. My favorite... Well, for me, it's different because I've grown up with a lot of guys playing, and then they end up playing on other teams. So I grew up playing with guys on the under-17 national team, 3 or 4 of which who have made it to the major league level. So when I get a chance to trade with them, it means more to me than it would to other guys, because it actually, there's some real meaning to it. Good question. Yes, anyone, go ahead.
Okay, so you know you were going to be asked about this. U.S. national team. Any interest in playing for them? Because we look pretty lost without you.
Yes, I do have interest in playing for the national team again. For those that don't know, it's been a while since I've been back in with the national team, and we're starting our qualifying this year. So it's a hectic time. I still feel like I needed some time to rest, but absolutely, if given the chance, then yes, I want to play again.
How have your relationships with your teammates on the club level been different from the international level?
Good
question.
Do you
still talk to those guys a lot?
Yeah, so when you play with the national team, you only see these guys sporadically throughout the year. So when you're with a team every day, they're almost more of your family than your real family is, because you see these guys every day. So sometimes it can be interesting integrating these. A lot of times guys are playing all over the world. They're coming from all sorts of different scenarios. So one of the main challenges of playing for your national team is we might play Saturday with the Galaxy. Wednesday we're playing with the national team, and guys are flying in from all over the world, and how quickly can you gel, not just on the field, but as teammates and people. So it's interesting. Yes?
Can you compare what it was like playing for Everton in the Premiership versus Galaxy on a championship team with Beckham and Robbie Keane?
Yeah, so in my opinion, the Premier League in England is the best league in the world. And I had a chance twice over the last few years to go play there for a few months during our off season in Major League Soccer. And you know, I talk about the passion of a World Cup. That's the passion that's exhibited every game at these, you know, places around the world, and particularly in England. So it's a lot of fun. It's more demanding, because here, if you make a bad pass, you know, kids are running around in the stadium and nobody cares as much. There, you make a bad pass and you got 10,000 people going, "What the fuck are you doing?" You know. So it's a different element, and it's more demanding for sure.
A quick follow-up, what was it like being able to play with Tim Howard and then against Dempsey on a completely different stage than the national team?
It's cool, because you play with these guys with your national team, but then with your club team, with the Galaxy, or in this case with Everton, you get to play against other players that you play with on your national team. Now you're playing against them. So it's always an interesting scenario. Most people don't know, our national team goalie, who's been there for a long time now, my first ever goal in Major League Soccer was against him. So I let him know that from time to time.
Well, thanks.
Yeah, no problem.
Hi. I'm actually a little nervous asking you a question.
Don't be nervous, man.
You're a pretty big star.
I'm just a little guy, you know. I can't hurt you.
You're going to be a little disappointed by me in a second. So we were watching the film. We saw you net that penalty kick. Mm-hmm. I remember back in 2009, you did an interview with ESPN in which they coined you as one of the best penalty kick takers in all the world. That was right before the MLS Cup final. I don't know if you remember what happened after that. Yeah.
Thanks for bringing that up, man.
Yeah, sorry about that. What I was really wondering is, as a soccer player, coming off one of your best seasons and ending on that note, how do you move into an off season?
Good question, because that was actually in 2009, which was the best year of my life and career. The interesting thing about that is I got back on the bus after the game. So we went into penalty kicks. I missed my penalty, and we ended up losing in the final. I got back on the bus, and I was sitting where I always sit in the bus, and I was emotional. I was kind of teary-eyed, but I had this moment where I realized I put everything I had into that season, that game, my life that year, and I was okay with it. I did everything I could, and I missed one kick. So what? And in the past, that would have devastated me, because I hadn't put everything in before that. And that year, I put my whole heart on the line. And because I missed a kick, I missed a kick, but I was okay with it.
Hey, Landon. Thanks for coming. The guy before me sort of asked the question I was going to ask, so I'm just going to ask you what it was like playing in the Merseyside derby. I think you played in one or maybe two. What was that like?
Where are you? Are you from? Are you a Liverpool fan?
Yeah.
Yeah? So one of the big things around the world in soccer is rivalries. They're a big deal. And similar to you guys with UCLA, there's, when I played at Everton, there's a massive rivalry that's been around for 100 plus years between Liverpool and the team I played for. And it's just, it's really special because in the way sports are now, players switch teams all the time. So you don't really have these allegiances like they used to. You guys used to play for 15, 20 years for one team, so they really cared. But the fans still care, you know, in these games. So when that week comes, you really feel the difference in the energy. And it's rivalry week. We're playing Liverpool. I had a chance to play in one of them, and it was a lot of fun.
Well, thanks.
You. My pleasure.
I wish you'd sign for us.
Yeah? It's not going to happen, buddy. Sorry. Okay.
Hi, Mr. Donovan.
Hi. Don't call me Mr. Donovan.
Oh, okay.
Jesus.
All right. Sorry. You mentioned that soccer is a big part of your identity. How would you like people to remember you by?
Great question. So it's actually not a big part of my identity to me, but it's how people identify me. I get quite, I guess, frustrated when people say, oh, are you the soccer player? And I'm like, no, I'm the person, you know? And but I understand, I get it. So like I said earlier, I feel like I have a lot more to give post-soccer playing. Fortunately, I have this beautiful platform that's been created to go effectuate change in the world, and I want to take full advantage of that. I really enjoy helping people. This is a form of it. I love doing this. I actually asked through my agent if I could come do this when I heard about Dave's class, and I said, do you think there'd be interest? Would you want me to? And fortunately, he acquiesced, and so it's been a pleasure to do this, and I really like doing it, and I guess that's how I would like to be remembered, someone who helped. Good question.
Hi. What are your thoughts on the new goal line technology, and who are you rooting for in the Champions League?
Nice jersey, dude. That's old school. In the Champions League?
It's Kobe Jones.
Oh. So, goal line technology, I'm all for it, because I think we should get the call's right. I would much rather them take a minute or two out of the game to make sure they got the call right than not. And Champions League, I mean, I don't particularly have a favorite, but it's pretty fun to watch Barcelona play. And I think it's good when teams that actually play beautiful style of soccer win, because it influences the rest of the teams around the world to try to do that too.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Hi.
Hey, how's it going? This question is about your time with the MLS. You've been a major figurehead for the MLS. You've seen it develop, especially being David Beckham's friend and teammate and seeing players like Henry, Marquez, Robbie Keane come into the sport in like the twilight of their careers. How do you feel? Are they coming just to fill their pockets at the end? Do you feel they can actually make a significance to the MLS and help the sport?
Well, I'll start by saying when I first started playing, we had 10 teams, and there was serious concern that the league wouldn't make it. Now there's 19 teams. It's thriving in most places. And now you're getting players like David Beckham, like Thierry Henry, that want to come here and want to be a part of it. I think now, in most cases, players are coming, you know, not necessarily because they want to make this huge difference on the field, but they're coming with a real mindset, like they're really coming to play, as opposed to the past, players would come here and just sort of vacation for a year and pick up a fat paycheck and they were happy about it. And now the teams are much more savvy about which players they sign and they're smarter about it. So it brings more legitimacy to our teams and our league. Thanks, no problem.
Hey, Landon. So he kind of asked a similar question
that
to what
sucks,
I was about
huh?
to ask, but I'll ask it anyways. You kind of been the face of MLS for the longest time now. Where do you personally think the MLS will be in the future? Do you see it as a feeder league like the Netherlands, or do you think it could become a world-class league?
That's a good question, probably more appropriate for my agent, or he could answer it better, but it's hard to know. There's a lot of leagues around the world that sort of pride themselves as just feeder leagues to the bigger leagues, and it's how they make money and how they profit. They develop players at a young age, and then they sell them to the Premier League in England or to Spain or to Germany. We're sort of in the midst of trying to find an identity. Do we want to be a league like that, or do we want to be like the Premier League one day? And knowing the way Americans are and how brass we are and how obnoxious we can be at times, my guess is that they're rooting for the latter and trying to become a top-notch league like everybody else.
Thank you.
Good question. Thanks. Hi.
Hi. Thanks for coming to speak to our class. I have a lot more personal question.
Okay.
So you mentioned when you were 17, breaking your leg was, like, looking back, one of the best things that could have happened to you and other events like that. And then you also said that you think the world is happening the way it's supposed to. Mm-hmm. So all religion aside, do you believe in a God or a higher power or more of a natural order of things?
Damn.
I told you it was personal.
No, that's good, good. I'm not religious in that sense of the word. I'm also not naive to think that our 70 or 80 or 90 years on Earth are really that important in the grand scheme of the world and where it's been and where it's going. We have this idea as human beings that we're so important, and we're not, in my opinion. So I do believe, I believe there's a higher power, and you can call it what you want. For some people it's God, for some people it's love. For some people, it's
for some help. People, those are the same thing.
Yes, perhaps. But I just think that, so tonight I'm leaving, I'm going to Cambodia by myself for 10 days. And I believe in a lot of Buddhist philosophies and theories, but what I always come back to is acceptance. And I don't see a need to be inflammatory when it comes to people believing what they want to believe. We all have different backgrounds, different socioeconomic reasons to believe different things, and I try to be an accepting person, and that's sort of my higher power.
Okay, awesome.
Good
Thank
question.
You.
Jeez.
Hey, Donovan.
It's got deep. Okay.
The national team's always had a pretty good defense. How do you guys plan to bounce back in the upcoming games without Bocanegra and without Onyewu? Mm-hmm. And also a follow-up, what are your thoughts and, I guess, how do you guys think you're going to perform against Mexico? In the
On who?
On Mexico. Oh, well, your comeback from the loss in Honduras.
Right.
And your thoughts and how do you think you're going to perform against Mexico?
Well, we've always... our national team, since I've been there, one of the things we pride ourselves on is we're a hard team to play against, and that starts defensively. So I think that's a mentality more than anything, and it's certainly something we need to get back to. As far as qualifying goes, so our first game was played about a month ago, beginning of this month, and we lost our first game, and we've got 9 left, and we've got to turn it around pretty quickly, so it's going to be probably a harder journey this time than it's ever been before, which will be challenging. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Michelle. Thank you for coming to speak to us. My question is, and you've talked about it briefly earlier, but when did you really start thinking about not only your life after soccer, but like what you wanted to do with your life after soccer?
I've sort of always thought about that stuff. A lot of athletes think that they can do this forever, which physically is impossible. So I'm atypical in that this is not all I do, this is not who I am, it's what I do for now. And I've thought about it for a long time. I have a lot of things that I'm excited to do and passionate about that have nothing to do with soccer. So I've been fortunate because a lot of athletes don't come to that realization for a while.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi.
Hi. Like you said earlier, there's like a lot of people that have kind of controlled your life or told you what you're good at, told you what to do. What are some of the things that you think you're good at or your strengths are that have helped you on the field, off the field, to get to the place you are today, soccer-wise, and as a person?
Good question. There's, I think I've always been a hard worker. And I think a common theme amongst any successful people is that you have to be a hard worker. I've always been very dedicated to what I do. So if I'm making dinner at home or playing in a soccer game or loving my nephew, I do it with everything I have. And I think that's an important way to go through life, and I think it's more often than not going to get you where you want to go. So those are qualities that I have in my life that have helped me a lot in soccer.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Last two questions, sorry.
Oh, sorry, guys.
Hey, so for many years you've been one of, if not the face of Major League Soccer, and so I was wondering, has it been like a concern for you, like something you've thought about for like the growth and popularity of Major League Soccer in the United States, or soccer in general in the United States?
What do you mean, in what way?
Has it been something that like you've always been, you've thought about like you'd like to promote and to continue?
Yeah, I'm proud. I'm very proud of what's happened in the States. I'm proud of what I've been a part of. I'm proud of what I will do in my life. And sometimes that can feel a little bit like a burden, but I realize there's much worse things than having that pressure on you. So it's been fun.
All right, thanks.
Thank you. Oof, last
Thank
one.
You for being here this evening.
Thank you.
I just wanted to ask you, I know that maybe in the U.S. soccer isn't the biggest sport, but in the rest of the world it is one of the most powerful sports. So as a representative of our country, and when you go to other countries in the world, how do you feel being an ambassador, and have you had any experiences where you feel like you have that weight with other countries looking at you as the representative of the U.S.?
Yeah, it's a good question, because we go places and a lot of times it's very black and white. They love us or they hate us. We were in Mexico after the after 2001, after September 11th. And I remember a game, we were playing a under-20 qualifier in Mexico, and there was a group of the fans, Mexican fans in the back, chanting Osama. And it was a pretty interesting moment, because, you know, in most cases, we're just dumb athletes playing a game, right? But for the rest of the world, they see us much differently, and they were in many ways representative of, or in their eyes, representative of what's going on in America. And so we get treated differently. But the other beauty of doing what we do is we go, you know, oftentimes when we drive to stadiums in foreign countries, we'll drive through the slums of some of these places, and it teaches you acceptance. You know, I think I grew up what I call American poor. You know, we ate Spam and like mac and cheese and hot dogs and top ramen and all that stuff and condensed milk growing up. So don't be a teacher if you want to make money, because my mom didn't make any money. But what I realized quickly is that we hit the jackpot by being where we are now. And many of you potentially could be from other parts of the world, and you understand that, but if you were born in America, and particularly in Southern California, you absolutely hit the jackpot. And always remember that, because, I mean, there's some bad places in the world.
Thank you.
All right.
Great questions, great answers. That's, told you it was gonna get deep.
I know, that's good, I like it.
I didn't expect it to get that deep. One last sort of conversation, then we'll get you guys out of here in like 10 minutes, because again, he has to get on a plane. We've alluded to a mutual friend that we have who sort of made this all happen. It's funny, you know, we were actually at my house in the fall, and, you know, having this nice conversation, and I just hear, well, you know, Landon would be great for your class. I mean, seriously? And, you know, ever since he said that, it's been great. So I wanted to bring him up and sort of talk about Rich's role in your life. And please, let's give a hand to Rich Motzkin, who made this happen. Rich. So Rich and I know each other. We go way back. We practiced law at the same law firm and played basketball and all that stuff. And then went on to leave the firm, became sort of the preeminent agent in soccer, particularly through soccer's growth, and, you know, is one of the key figures in its growth in the U.S., represented, you know, everybody from the beginning all the way through Landon and has the next generation. But I wanted to talk about, you know, what's it been like first, what's it been like representing Landon since he was how old?
16 years old.
Mm-hmm. Talk about that, and then we're going to ask you sort of what it's been like.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's
you know, a lot of it is surreal. I mean, when you start sitting here and you look at the video clips and, you know, my wife and I, Randy, were at the 99 U17 World Cup effectively as Landon's family. And, you know, first off, it's just wonderful to see the growth and development of Landon as a person. And as a, and I've told this to a lot of people, and you guys are getting a lot more insight into Landon than, you know, almost anyone does, quite frankly. And what it reflects to me, and, you know, like, we have a very special relationship, we're family, but just, you know, Landon's not your typical athlete, and it's just to watch his growth as a person over the years. And I've always said that Landon's a much better person than he is a soccer player, and I think you guys can see that firsthand in that.
And then what's it been like, this relationship that you've had since you were a teenager?
Well, Rich and I first met, we got a recommendation to call this agent, and our thought of agents was much like everyone else's, which is slimy and sleazy and all this. So we asked Rich to drive out to Redlands, which is a bit of a hike, and he went to see a high school soccer game of mine. And I think he would tell you after watching, it wasn't my best day at the office.
Like, are you kidding me? This is the guy they're talking about?
I had a rough go that day. And but it was my mom especially could tell from the beginning that there was something different and something special. And the majority of athletes switch agents all the time. And I've been very fortunate. We talked about father figures. Rich was, in many ways, my first father figure. And it's a beautiful thing to have that as an athlete, because a lot of times you don't know, can you trust this person? Can you not trust this person? And that has been the baseline of our relationship. So I don't want to get all like emotional and stuff in here. But I guess the lesson is, as Rich always says, life is about relationships. And so as you guys go along your journeys, don't forget that. Don't burn bridges. You never know who's going to come back where and who you're going to need to help you, and vice versa. But the better relationships you can build, even if you're dealing with people in a business sense, it goes a long way and it makes a difference.
Well, it's great. If you guys are family, then I guess that makes us family, because this is as close as it gets. Yeah. We wanted to give you a couple things to thank you for coming here and sharing your story with us. First is Candace. Candace, please join us up on stage. Can I borrow that mic for Candace?
Oh, this is for me? Oh.
I'm honored to thank you for coming here tonight.
Uh-oh. Don't be nervous.
I was going to drop. I only have one small hand. And sharing your love and passion for the game, and we're really going to take your advice, drive, and determination to heart as we start our own careers and companies. And on behalf of the USC students, we'd like to present both of you with these awards, as well as a USC scarf, because, you know, we're much better than the school down the block.
All right.
You get the scarf.
This is for you.
Thank you very much.
This is for you. Thank you guys so much for coming. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Candace. It's a nice pillow in there. How's that, all right?
I just heard that they offered you a full ride here, so. Yeah.
If he's got any eligibility left, we've got a men's soccer team. So the scarf has got the logo of the entrepreneur program, the Gripe Center. And what it is, it's marching dots, and there's one dot that's set apart from the rest, and that's the entrepreneur. And in this case, that's the outlier, right? If you've read Malcolm Gladwell's book about outliers, it talks about discipline, purposeful practice of 10,000 hours, and I'm sure you've got more than that. If you look at the award, so Landon says Beyond the Field, the Leap, February 20th, 2013. Rich, what does your inscription say?
Free Talent Booker.
Rich brought Casey Wasserman 2 years ago and brought Landon.
That's
so
good.
Let's thank them again, and we've got one more thing. So tonight is about both history and next chapters. History, the history that Landon's made in the MLS, in his career, and the next chapter he's going to start very soon. So we wanted to bring up some people from USC that are both making history and starting a new chapter. Please welcome the women's lacrosse team and coaches, please.
First of all, we just wanted to say thank you so much for coming tonight and sharing your story. And, you know, as a new program here at USC that has really high hopes to dream big and to be really successful, it's awesome and inspiring to hear your story and not only the success that you've had, which is, you know, incredible, but really, you know, the setbacks that you've had and that you stayed on course and sort of believed throughout that whole time. And you know, it's something that we're gonna take with us. So we wanted to present you a lacrosse stick that was signed by all the members of the team and a t-shirt that screams USC lacrosse. So when you wear it in LA, everyone can know who you're rooting for.
That's
so
awesome.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That's awesome.
Get a picture.
Thank you guys.
Make sure you get a picture with the whole team here. Let's get that set up. This is, as most of you know by now, this is the first season of USC women's lacrosse. It's 2 years in the making.
I don't even know.
And it's it won't be long before it makes history. So let's get a picture with the professional photographer.
In. Hi, guys.
Jump in the middle there.
What? Don't be by you or be by you? Okay. I don't want you to get mad or nothing. All right.
Yeah, Landon, your life sucks.
That's tough.
All right, smile, and then everyone, two fingers, fight on. Landon, you know it. You know it, brother. Wait till we send this over to Westwood.
Cool.
All right.
You're very welcome. Good luck, guys. Good luck. You're welcome. Good luck. Have fun. Thank you. You're very welcome. Thank you.
I promised I would get him out of here quickly, but if you want to come up, shake his hand, say hello, meet Landon. We're going to get him out. Thank you so much. One more time for Landon
Donovan.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.